By most measures, the federal government's turn back the boats policy has been a major success. The boats and the deaths at sea have largely stopped, but for the asylum seekers who've been sent back, the story is certainly not over. Tonight's investigation into the fate of Sri Lankan asylum seekers who've been recently returned contains very disturbing allegations. The Sri Lankan High Commissioner is standing by in our Canberra studio to respond live after the story. Dr. David Corlett, the presenter of Go Back to Where You Came From, went undercover for Dateline for this report.
This is a journey through a country recovering from decades of civil war. A story about secret meetings.
It's 3 o'clock in the morning. Not sure where the next leg of our journey will take us.
People too terrified to reveal their identity or location. And harrowing claims of abduction and torture by the security forces.
It's absolutely brutal.
Including failed asylum seekers sent back from Australia.
They tied my leg with wire and lifted me up with my head down.
So they're hanging you upside down.
On any weekend in Colombo, the beach is a great place to relax. The capital is bustling. Five years after the once feared Tamil Tigers were finally destroyed. As the nation grows, Australia is developing close ties, including a federal police presence and providing patrol boats in the battle against people smugglers.
It's terrific to be here in Colombo. It's good to be here with senior members of the Sri Lankan Navy, particularly the Admiral commanding the Navy.
President Mahinda Rajapaksa is pledging a bright future for the nation and reconciliation between Tamils and Sinhalese. But today I'm on my way to hear a very different story. A woman we'll call Anusha, who was returned from Australia, has agreed to meet me. Elaborate precautions are in place to protect her identity.
Okay, so I need to call her and then she will give directions.
I meet her at a construction site. She says she's made 2 attempts to reach Australia and that men from the Sri Lankan security forces gang-raped her before she got on the boat.
Actually, if you are human, you won't do this. You try to rape the woman. Then I cry. Then he hit me all over my body with the weapon. 7 soldiers tape my hand, and 7 soldiers already ripped me. They really make me very badly.
On her second attempt, Australian officials sent her back. Anusha says because of her political associations, she spends her life in fear and moving constantly.
We are going to leave the country as soon as possible. This is our baggage to take with us. This is all. You can see.
Well, thank you.
Okay. Okay, sir.
Not far from Anusha's is another secret location and more allegations of abuse. Narada says he was also returned from Australia and assaulted by police.
Mata gahanna patangatta mata painut gahuwa mama taw kiwa mata gahanna epa Australia ave me hama deyakma balaagena innawa kiyala Lankawa neethiya Australia ave neethiyata wenas umbe wedak balaagena hitapan Australia ave neethiya walangu ehata kiyala eya kiwa Australia ave
Narada's case is known to Australian authorities, and we will return to it later. Today, my contacts have lined up another secret meeting. It's a drive that takes us past more of Sri Lanka's charms. But again, I'm about to experience this country's hidden side. This man claims he was returned by Australia and then abused by Sri Lankan officials during a 9-hour interrogation. We'll call him Adi. He says the security forces accused him of being with the Tamil Tigers, or LTTE. Five years after the resounding defeat of the LTTE, the government is determined to prevent a resurgence and find out what they can about any surviving tigers. Shortly after the interview, my translator receives a phone call.
He advised that we leave immediately from this place because people have identified you as a foreigner doing an investigation into human rights.
What are the implications, do you think?
We can be taken, arrested, interrogated.
Okay, let's go. The government is also deeply sensitive to accusations that it committed war crimes in the final days of the war, a charge it strongly denies. The same allegation is also levelled at the Tigers. On the road the next day, I receive another call saying I should take the battery and SIM card from my phone to avoid being tracked. I was planning to return to Colombo, but I received a call saying that I should instead spend a day being a tourist. Sigiriya, or Lion Rock, is one of Sri Lanka's premier tourist destinations.
So yesterday was a pretty dramatic turn of events. I wasn't expecting that. I was contacted by somebody else who suggested that we might be being tailed. And so we needed to stop, have tea, watch our backs, and then move on with caution.
It's hard to reconcile the natural beauty and hospitality here with what I've been experiencing. A sense of dread and constant surveillance. Is this paranoia, or is the level of fear justified? Both the Sri Lankan and Australian governments say this country is safe. The answer may lie almost 9,000 kilometres away. It's summer in London. The locals and tourists are lapping it up. But it seems not everyone is able to enjoy the good times. I've come to meet Sri Lankans who claim they've been brutally abused. They fled not to Australia, but here to the UK. This is barrister Patrick Lewis. For 20 years, he's been specialising in immigration and human rights law and has represented up to 70 Sri Lankans seeking asylum in the UK.
Hi, I just arrived.
He says there's a consistency to their claims.
So it's of individuals being detained, arrested, and then subjected to various forms of beating, of various forms of torture, including burning, including sexual abuse, including rape.
அது பிறகு ஒரு பொலித்தீன் பேக்கில் பெட்ரோலை நினைச்சி வைத்திருந்தார்கள் அதை என்னுடைய தலையில் கட்டி போட்டு பிறகு என்னை அடித்து உதைத்தார்கள் எனக்கு சரியான வேதனையாக இருந்தது என்னுடைய கண் சரியாக இடியவும் துவங்கிட்டு பிறகு கண் சரியாக வீங்கவும் துவங்கிட்டு
Last year, 4 years after the end of the war, Nathan says security forces picked him up.
நான் கடையில் இருந்து திருப்பி வீட்டுக்கு சென்று கொண்டிருந்தான். உள்ளுக்குள்ளே சில நபர்கள் ஆயுதத்தோடு இருந்தார்கள். அப்போது ஒரு ஒயிட் வேன் பக்கத்தில் வந்து நிப்பாடிச்சுது. உடனே அவர்கள் என்ன வேனுக்குள்ளே இழுத்து போட்டார்கள். உடனேயே என்ன வேனுக்குள்ளே வச்சு அடித்தார்கள். அதுக்கு பிறகு என்னை அடித்து நீ விடுதலை புலிகள் உறுப்பினரோ என்று கேட்டு அடித்தார்கள். நான் இல்லை என்று மறுக்கவும் அவர்கள் என்னை தொடர்ச்சியாக அடித்து உதைத்தார்கள். அடுத்த நாள் என்னை காலை கட்டி தலையிலாக தொங்க விட்டு அடித்தார்கள். திரும்பி அடித்தும் பட்சத்தில் என்னோட இயலாத பட்சத்தில் நான் செய்யும்படியும் கேட்டார். நான் மறுத்த பொழுது விரட்டி என்னை வாய்ப்போஸ் பண்ணினார்.
Nathan says he was also racially abused.
நீ ஒரு தமிழ் நாயை செத்து போடா, எங்களுக்கு எதிராக விடுதலை புலிகள் இயக்கத்தோடு இருந்து சண்டை பிடிச்சனே.
ஒவ்வொரு இரவிலே நாலு இல்லை அஞ்சு ஆண்கள் மாறி மாறி என்னை ரேப் பண்ணுவாங்க. அண்ட் தென் அதை விட வயர் மின்சாரத்தாலேயெல்லாம் என்னை சுடுவாங்க. அந்த சுட்டத்தால் எனக்கு பின்னுக்கு நிறைய அடையாளம் இருக்குது. நான் தொடர்ந்து சித்திரவதை அனுபவித்து வந்தேன். நான் நிறைய இதெல்லாம் வெளியில் சொல்கிறதுக்கு எனக்கு வெக்கமாக இருக்குது.
Horrific stories like these have been compiled in this report, published in March by the Bar Human Rights Committee of England and Wales and the International Truth and Justice Project, Sri Lanka.
It's absolutely brutal. And, you know, I felt like a voyeur sometimes having to deal with what I would call a pornography of violence, because both men and women are raped both anally and in the case of the women, vaginally and anally.
The report's author is Yasmin Suka, an internationally respected human rights lawyer. She has advised many governments and sat on the UN Secretary General's expert panel on post-war Sri Lanka.
None of our witnesses actually know each other. None of them were actually interviewed in the same places by the same investigators. And yet, if you read the accounts of torture and sexual violence, it is strikingly similar, and that really gives support to my view that this is planned, it is systematic, and that to me indicates a high level of support at the highest level, and secondly a high level of impunity in the country.
When I go before the courts, I'm there as an independent expert. My primary duty is then to the court, not to the individual.
Medical experts, including Dr. Frank Arnold, a surgeon who specialises in assessing torture survivors, examined the victims in detail.
The results of the examination were that she had scars, a diagnostic of cigarette burns.
Which means what? What's that mean in lay terms?
That means it could not have happened any other way.
அவரென்று வரைக்கும் அவர் என்னை சிகரெட்டால் சுடுவார். அதனால் எனக்கு காயங்கள் இருக்குது. நான் குளிக்கும் போதெல்லாம் கவலையாக இருக்கும் அந்த காயங்களை பார்க்க. அது பழைய விஷயங்கள் எல்லாம் ஞாபகப்படுத்தும்.
Brahmi sought asylum with her daughter in Europe, but was returned to Sri Lanka. She says she was also abducted by men in a white van and subjected to relentless torture and sexual abuse.
நாலஞ்சு ஆண்கள் ஆர்மியும் சிவில் யூனிஃபார்ம்லேயும் இருந்தார்கள். கொஞ்சத்தால் என்னால் அவர்களோட போராட முடியலை. போராடி நிறுத்த முடியலை. ஸோ அவங்களை ரேப் பண்ண விட்டேன்.
She also showed marks from branding with hot metal rods on her back. And that's a particularly shocking and uniquely Sri Lankan phenomenon, which I've seen again and again and again. We have here also a couple of photographs, not of her, but of a man who said he was branded with hot metal rods. And this is one of the people who I saw in 2013, long after the end of the Civil War.
It's not only London doctors who are dealing with Sri Lankans who report being branded. In Melbourne last year, the ABC's Heather Ewart reported on Kumar.
Kumar, do you mind showing me what the scars are on your back?
Yes, sure.
You okay? Oh, that's terrible.
Kumar also says he was sexually assaulted. He says he eventually bribed his way out of Sri Lanka. Also in Melbourne is a man we'll call Banu. His asylum claim was rejected and he was sent back to Sri Lanka, but has since made his way back again. He says while in Sri Lanka, he was also accused of being a Tamil tiger and tortured.
They always hit me. They took this nail and this nail and this one. They removed with one of those things they use with electricity.
Like pliers?
Yes.
On another occasion, at a different location, he says his ankles and wrists were tied behind him.
They put two chairs with a pole between them and put me like this. Very painful.
So you're sort of hanging?
Yeah.
Banu says that his torture happened here on the fourth floor of the CID building in Colombo. It was also here that the man I met earlier, Narada, who was known to Australian authorities, says he was tortured.
පස්සේ වතුර පයිප්පයකින් වතුර ඇල්ලුවා. ඔළුවේ ඉඳ පල්ලෙහාට. මම හිතන්නේ ඒක කරේ ගඳ යවන්න.
Documents obtained under Freedom of Information show the Australian government was aware of Narada's torture claims.
We have been forwarded an email containing claims that a suspect has been severely tortured by police. The email is signed by the suspect's lawyer.
Alerted to these allegations, an Australian federal police officer went to investigate, inquiring of the very people accused of torturing Narada.
AFP raised the allegations with the director of the Criminal Investigations Division. He subsequently advised that the allegations had no basis.
The AFP also cited Narada, who, they said,
appears to be in good health.
But the federal police chose not to ask him personally whether he had been tortured, asserting that,
in the interest of keeping our distance, we do not intend to meet with him.
That statement would appear to contradict this briefing note prepared for the Department of Foreign Affairs, which states that,
any reports of harm are taken seriously and would be followed up.
Narada's torture, if true, casts doubt on the assertions of former Foreign Affairs Minister Bob Carr.
Since 2010, there has been no evidence of returnees being discriminated against or arrested, let alone tortured. And I think it's wrong to say that Tamils live in fear and are fleeing their country.
Since late 2012, over 1,300 Sri Lankans have been returned under a policy known as enhanced screening.
This government's policy is the same as, effectively the same or the extension of the last government.
By his own estimate, Greg Lake, the Immigration Department's former Director of Offshore Processing and Transfers, says he was responsible for returning approximately 1,000 of these people.
The idea of it being somehow enhanced or better is exactly the opposite of what it is. It was enhanced by making it shorter, less questions, less opportunity to put your story. We're going to apply this interview for legal purposes, really, and then send you home.
The interview is brief and, according to Anusha, was not the place to tell her full story.
Giving interview by the over the phone, when they are asking and they're getting taking an interview, three or four Sri Lankan passengers are with me, with behind. So my personal things, even I can't tell to, I'm scared because if they can make, because I can't trust 100% people.
There's a huge chance that quite a few people, and by that I could mean tens, possibly hundreds, have been subjected to all sorts of treatment on return to Sri Lanka. I don't know how many, but I think it's a worry that any might have been.
No one, it seems, knows just how many of those Australia has sent back to Sri Lanka have been mistreated. A spokesperson for Immigration Minister Scott Morrison says they rely on assurances given to Bob Carr by the Sri Lankan government and have not received any new information that would enable further investigation. A lawyer in Colombo with up to 200 returnee clients estimates half have had problems.
Some people were detained, some people were tortured, some people were like followed by a lot, and they are monitored.
It was Lakshan Diaz whose email alerted the Australian High Commission that his client Narada had been tortured.
Torture is kind of accepted way of interrogation in Sri Lanka, even though it's illegal totally, but everybody knows what's happening. So how can someone say that is not going to apply for those returnees?
It's not only human rights defenders who say that torture is pervasive. Concerns have reached the highest levels.
It's systematic, but it's so systematic that the British government, in a recent case, conceded that those individuals who are at risk of detention in Sri Lanka are at risk of torture and of sexual abuse and rape whilst they're in detention.
Clearly, not everyone returned to Sri Lanka is in danger. But Yasmin Suka is dismayed at Australia's willingness to return as many as possible.
This is quite frightening, and in fact is tantamount to collaborating with a government that is responsible for human rights abuses.
For many, this once war-torn nation has become an inviting tourist playground. But for those sent back to where they came from, it may be a very different story.
David Corlett with that report. And I'm joined now by Sri Lanka's High Commissioner to Australia, Admiral Thisara Samarasinghe. Thanks for joining us, sir. There is some horrifying allegations. Horrifying allegations in that story. How did you feel hearing them?
Mark, your word of horrifying is absolutely not the right way to describe that. Doctored, orchestrated, biased, documentary, which is absolutely baseless, and any person with ounce of common sense and can read and understand certain languages of
sure.
that documentary is clearly give the evidence that how biased that documentary is, and it's trying to portray an absolutely wrong picture of Sri Lanka, and I totally reject that.
All right, but let's look at just some of the specific claims. They're not generic claims of intimidation. They're quite specific allegations of rape and, of course, the rather horrific instances of branding. Whether the overall flavour is to your liking, they appear to be true, those accounts. Do they disturb you?
It could be appearing to be true to you, to any particular person. The specifics are that it is obviously is doctored, and it has been timed at times when there is a lot of attempts by various quarters to damage Sri Lanka's image and bring out certain
would you accept? I won't banter with you. I understand the Sri Lankan government's position. There have been false accusations made against the government before, but there's an essence of truth through much of that story, at the very least. Would you agree? And on a personal level, at least, how do you feel when you hear claims such as that of your security forces treating detainees in that manner?
Mark, there are 11,000 hardcore terrorists who are either arrested or detained or surrendered, who had been released to normal life after rehabilitation. It will be very unprofessional to pick somebody returning from Australia and go and ask him, are you a LTT member? That is absolutely unprofessional for the Sri Lankan military and authorities. Self-infliction of injuries are common in this kind of atrocities. There are people who committed suicide to bring discredit to people. So these pictures, and also people who are arrested, tortured, abducted, raped, are free to leave the country and go to other parts of the world. I mean, there should be consistency in what something is said. And I'm expecting anyone, that reporter, if he can bring any credible evidence and bring such person to my notice, I'll give you the guarantee, 100% guarantee, that particular person who is claiming that X, Y, and Z has happened will be absolutely safe. This is an attempt to support the separatism in Sri Lanka, paint a wrong picture, and we have stopped, with the help of Australian government, people dying at sea, and the criminals, human smugglers, are struggling now. So this is the propaganda work.
There's no argument on that point, sir. I think it's more quite specific to these instances, and I'm sure the our journalists will take you up on that offer. But the basis of that story was the UK report, which was delivered in March. Has there been an investigation into that report? If not, my last question, if not, why not?
We are not investigating to various reports done by various people for vested interests. The UK and other countries have harbored this terrorist leadership, and that is why our country suffered for so long in our attempt to eradicate terrorism. Even now they are harboring terrorists. So harboring this kind of people and spending various monies to discredit Sri Lanka is very open, and the double standards which have been meted out. And if there are people who are returning after fleeing the country for greener postures or and economic opportunities, when they come back, there are thousands who are living normal life.
Okay,
there are agencies that they can go and report. And
we'll have to leave it there. Thank you, but we're happy to pursue it on our website. Any comments you've got to make? There's more online from David Corlett's story, including the federal government's full response to our questions, and a link to the human rights report featured in that story. That's at sbs.com.au/dateline.